LA Theater Works presents The Importance of Being Earnest by Oscar Wilde, starring Emily Burgle, Charles Bush, Neil Dixon, Jill Gascoigne, James Marsters, Christopher Neame, Matthew Wolfe, and Sarah Zimmerman. Directed by Michael Hackett. Lead funding for this production is provided by the Sidney E. Frank Foundation. Oscar Wilde's final play is a stylish send-up of Victorian manners, complete with misguided lovers, mistaken identities, maddening relatives, and a misplaced handbag. With its surreal farce and zinging one-liners, Wilde's masterpiece paved the way for P.G. Wodehouse, screwball comedies, and, of course, Monty Python. After the play, I'll speak with our director, Michael Hackett, professor of theater at the UCLA School of Theater, Film, and Television. And now, The Importance of Being Earnest by Oscar Wilde.
I was playing, Lane.
I didn't think it polite to listen, sir.
I'm sorry for that, for your sake. Oh. I don't play accurately. Anyone can play accurately. But I play with wonderful expression. As far as the piano is concerned, sentiment is my forte. I keep science for life.
Yes, sir.
And speaking of the science of life, have you got the cucumber sandwiches cut for Lady Bracknell?
Yes, sir.
Oh, by the way, Lane, I see from your book that on Thursday night, when Lord Shoreman and Mr. Worthing were dining with me, 8 bottles of champagne are entered as having been consumed.
Yes, sir. 8 bottles and a pint.
Why is it that at a bachelor's establishment, the servants invariably drink the champagne? I ask merely for information.
I attribute it to the superior quality of the wine, sir. I have often observed that in married households, the champagne is rarely of a first-rate brand.
Good heavens, is marriage so demoralizing as that?
I believe it is a very pleasant state, sir. I have had very little experience of it myself up to the present. I have only been married once. That was in consequence of a misunderstanding between myself and a young woman.
I don't know that I am much interested in your family life, Lane.
No, sir, it is not a very interesting subject. I never think of it myself.
Very natural, I'm sure. That will do, Lane, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Lane's views on marriage seem somewhat lax. Really, if the lower orders don't set us a good example, what on earth is the use of them? They seem as a class to have absolutely no sense of moral responsibility.
Mr. Ernest Worthing.
Ah, how are you, my dear Ernest? What brings you up to town?
Oh, pleasure, pleasure. What else should bring one anywhere? Eating, as usual, I see, Algy.
I believe it is customary in good society to take some light refreshment at 5 o'clock. Where have you been since last Thursday?
In the country.
What on earth do you do there?
When one is in town, one amuses oneself. When one is in the country, one amuses other people. It is excessively boring.
And who are the people you amuse?
Oh, neighbours, neighbours.
Got nice neighbours in your part of Shropshire?
Perfectly horrid. Never speak to one of them.
How immensely you must amuse them. By the way, Shropshire is your county, is it not?
Shropshire, yes, of course. Hello! Why all these cups? Why cucumber sandwiches? Why such reckless extravagance in one so young who is coming to tea?
Oh, merely Aunt Augusta and Gwendolyn.
How perfectly delightful!
Yes, that is all very well, but I'm afraid Aunt Augusta won't quite approve of your being here.
May I ask why?
My dear fellow, the way you flirt with Gwendolyn is perfectly disgraceful. It is almost as bad as the way Gwendolyn flirts with you.
I'm in love with Gwendolyn. I've come up to town expressly to propose to her.
I thought you had come up for pleasure. I call that business.
How utterly unromantic you are.
I really don't see anything romantic in proposing. It is very romantic to be in love, but there is nothing romantic about a definite proposal. Why, one may be accepted. One usually is, I believe. Then the excitement is all over. The very essence of romance is uncertainty. If ever I get married, I shall certainly try to forget the fact.
I have no doubt about that, dear Algy. The divorce court was specially invented for people whose memories are so curiously constituted.
Oh, there is no use speculating on that subject. Divorces are made in heaven. Please don't touch the cucumber sandwiches. They are ordered specially for Aunt Augusta.
Well, you have been eating them all the time.
That is quite a different matter. She is my aunt. Have some bread and butter. The bread and butter is for Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn is devoted to bread and butter.
And very good bread and butter it is, too.
Well, my dear fellow, you need not eat as if you were going to eat it all. You behave as if you were married to her already. You are not married to her already, and I don't think you ever will be.
Why on earth do you say that?
Well, in the first place, girls never marry the men they flirt with. Girls don't think it right.
Oh, that is nonsense.
It isn't. It is a great truth. It accounts for the extraordinary number of bachelors that one sees all over the place. In the second place, I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
My dear fellow, Gwendolyn is my first cousin, and before I allow you to marry her, you will have to clear up the whole question of Cecily.
Cecily? What on earth do you mean? What do you mean, Algy, by Cecily? I don't know anyone by the name of Cecily.
Oh, Lane?
Yes, sir?
Bring me that cigarette case Mr. Worthing left in the smoking room the last time he dined here.
Yes, sir.
Do you mean to say that you've had my cigarette case all this time? I wish to goodness you'd let me know. I've been writing frantic letters to Scotland Yard about it. I was very nearly offering a large reward.
Well, I wish you would offer one. I happen to be more than usually hard up.
There's no good offering a large reward now that the thing is found.
Ah, the cigarette case. Thank you, Lane.
Thank you, sir.
I think that is rather mean of you, Ernest, I must say. However, it makes no matter, for now that I look at the inscription, I find that the thing isn't yours after all.
Of course it's mine. You've seen me with it 100 times. And you have no right whatsoever to read what's inside. It is a very ungentlemanly thing to read a private cigarette case.
Oh, it is absurd to have a hard and fast rule about what one should read and what one shouldn't. More than half of modern culture depends on what one shouldn't read.
I'm quite aware of the fact, and I don't propose to discuss modern culture. It isn't the sort of thing one should talk of in private. I simply want my cigarette case back.
Yes, but this isn't your cigarette case. This cigarette case is a present from someone of the name of Cecily. And you said you didn't know anyone of that name.
Well, if you want to know, Cecily happens to be my aunt.
Your aunt?
Yes. Charming old lady, she is too. Lives at Tunbridge Wells. Just give it back to me, Algy.
But why does she call herself Little Cecily if she is your aunt and lives at Tunbridge Wells? From Little Cecily with her fondest love.
Well, my dear fellow, what on earth is there in that? Some aunts are tall, some aunts are not tall. That is surely a matter that an aunt may be allowed to decide for herself. You seem to think that every aunt should be exactly like your aunt. That is absurd. For heaven's sake, give me back my cigarette case.
Yes, but why does your aunt call you her uncle? From Little Cecily with her fondest love to her dear Uncle Jack. There is no objection, I admit, to an aunt being a small aunt. But why an aunt, no matter what her size may be, should call her own nephew her uncle, I can't quite make out. Besides, your name isn't Jack at all. It is Ernest.
It isn't Ernest. It's Jack.
You have always told me it was Ernest. I've introduced you to everyone as Ernest. You answer to the name of Ernest. You look as if your name is Ernest. You're the most earnest-looking person I ever saw in my life. It is perfectly absurd you're saying your name isn't Ernest. It's on your cards. Here is one of them. Mr. Ernest Worthing, B4, the Albany. I'll keep this as a proof that your name is Ernest, if ever you attempt to deny it, to me, or to Gwendolyn, or to anyone else.
Well, my name is Ernest in town and Jack in the country, and the cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but that does not account for the fact that your small Aunt Cecily, who lives at Tunbridge Wells, calls you her dear uncle. Come, old boy, you had much better have the thing out at once.
My dear Algy, you talk exactly as if you were a dentist. It is very vulgar to talk like a dentist when one isn't a dentist. It produces a false impression.
Well, that is exactly what dentists always do. Now go on, tell me the whole thing. I may mention that I have always suspected you of being a confirmed and secret Bunburyist, and I am quite sure of it now.
Bunburyist? What on earth do you mean by Bunburyist?
I'll reveal to you the meaning of that incomparable expression as soon as you are kind enough to inform me why you are Ernest in town and Jack in the country.
Well, produce my cigarette case first.
Here it is. Now produce your explanation, and pray make it improbable.
My dear fellow, there is nothing improbable about my explanation at all. In fact, it's perfectly ordinary. Old Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me when I was a little boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew. Cecily, who addresses me as her uncle from motives of respect that you could not possibly appreciate, lives at my place in the country, under the charge of her admirable governess, Miss Prism.
Where is that place in the country, by the way?
That is nothing to you, dear boy. You are not going to be invited. I may tell you candidly that the place is not in Shropshire.
I suspected that, my dear fellow. I have Bunburyed all over Shropshire on 2 separate occasions. Now go on. Why are you Ernest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear Algy, I don't know whether...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.